Hi everybody at the Commodore LA Super Show. We have Simon here. He's going to talk about music and all that kind of stuff. So Simon, maybe you could give an introduction of yourself and what you're doing, okay?
Okay, first of all, I did not rehearse this presentation, so sometimes I get stuck. I want to anticipate that this because it's not rehearsed, it's all on the setup. I have a basic script, but I did in some of the things that I'm going to show you are not rehearsed. So I expect any bloopers. For the role, I will ask for the credits to Robert. Okay, so first of all, I want to say who am I. Okay, my full name, Simone Bernacchia. I'm from Italy. I moved here on the States in 2005. For what concerns the background of Amiga, I used to be part of a demo group called Quasar, a local one, small one in my area. And I have the background that I do also as a pixel artist. I did graphic for the video game. One commercial one that I worked mostly of the time was called Powder for Amiga. It is a long story, it's a completely different subject. That's good for another talk, I guess. Lot of things there. And beside that, I also have a background as a musician. I started to go in computing when I was in my 13, 14, and my first computer has been a Sinclair Spectrum. So exactly not the best computer for music, as you know. But actually I was trying to do my games in BASIC and then compiling it, and I also stumbled in some routine that will allow me to do like two-channel music, even if they were pretty slow, because even compiled BASIC is not the best. And it was all done through data. So your data instruction, you put all the data for the music, and you hope the things will sound good anyway. Then when I bought an Amiga in 1988, I started to play with Sonics, and that's where I started to develop a bit my music side, beside the graphic side that I was doing on Deluxe Paint. And later on, somebody showed me Sound Effects, a program of Lionel that is another tracker, has an interface that is less powerful than the Pro Tracker or Noise Tracker, Sound Tracker that we know. And a different sound format, a bit more elastic on the octaves and different effects. But that's what I learned the basic of tracking. That somebody, the same somebody was a friend of mine, showed me Noise Tracker. That is like a Sound Tracker clone. At the time, Sound Tracker was a commercial program, so the demo group started to come with their own versions. And there were even some incompatibilities in the way that they handle some of the effects. So I started my musician career there. I had occasion to do music for animations, including mine, and for a friend of mine, Marco Maltese, that right now is in a completely different sector. He also used to work with Crytek, it was on the 3D, and now instead is a advocate for electronic currency like Bitcoin, things like that. For what concerned me, my Amiga adventure kind of fade out, I was also looking for Java. I went to in web design, and then later on, when I moved in the States, I become also a web developer. I worked for several companies, including iHeartMedia. And right now I'm doing a completely different job. I try to do two jobs because they don't pay enough the bills, because after I got laid off by iHeartMedia, I had to find another employment. I actually live in Santa Clarita and I started to do music when I was in 2008, 2009, when somebody pointed me to Milky Tracker here on the PC. Because before I tried to go back to do some music using MP3, I used MPT, what is now called as Mod Plug Tracker on Mac. But it was too immature, it was not working properly, so I was unable to do anything. If I wanted to do music, I do it on my Amiga, then I record it with a protractor. And I come back using Mickey Trucker, and then in 2014 somebody was looking for music on EAB, for music for some of its games, and I decided to try to go back home. I started several projects. One of those that is still in progress and I'm kind of stuck on is the recreation of the music of Heroes and Might and Magic 2 on Protracker, and the requested quality is pretty high, and the time is tight, so I try to work when I can on that one, but it's still in progress. Besides that, I did a lot of projects lately, and those are my main tools. When I was in Italy and then my Amiga 1200 there, my main tools were mostly Protracker, Audio Master, and mostly Protracker, Audio Master, and then a sound sampler. Here, what I use is mostly Mickey Tracker. Then I did some work. Somebody asked me to do some job, like an example, a soundtrack for the version of Lumberjack for Game Boy, so I did try to use Deform Mask. I think the people that is on music know that is a tracker that work with FM chips, so it can work for NES, it can work for Genesis, Omega Drive, I did it in Europe. It can work also for arcade music or Master System. And sometimes I use it to create FM samples and then send it to my thing, and then use it on the Mickey Tracker. Then Audacity to process audio. A Wave Studio that is like a small suite of audio tools, and allow me to do like batch conversion of samples and downsampling in batch. And they also support IFF, that is the audio format of Amiga, 1994 format of Amiga. Then lately I asked somebody point me to Hoot, that is like a player for FM audio from arcades or from other machines, like maybe 68000, PC9801. And that I will show you sometime is useful, especially for sound conversion from arcade. Then another program that I use sometimes, and then the music with one of the colleagues of the club here is Arcos Tracker. That is a program that supports the YM, I think it's 2914, I forget the number, but it's the chip used by Spectrum, it's a chip used by the Radio Shack TRS-80, so that is a tracker for this machine, and he's doing a project on his TRS-80, and I'm doing the music on it. Then there is a MIDI program, open source Corario Maestosa, that I use when I need to come out in general MIDI. And of course to test on Amiga environment, since I don't have any Amiga with me, I use WinUAE. Those are the most of the tools that I use here. First of all I want to say I consider myself what I call a bedroom musician. You know, there are bedroom programmers, that is these people that learn to code in their own bedroom and they do their own project. I consider myself a bedroom musician because I don't have a music background. So all that I have is mostly self-learned, okay, some basic from school, but for the music, for the melody structure, for everything is self-learned, is referral from other sources or by experimentation. We are mostly talking about your Amiga music, and doing game for music is an interesting branch. You know, there are still a lot of active musicians on the demo scene, especially for Amiga and for other format. But then game music is a different branch, because while in demo scene, especially for track and competition or demo, your limits are pretty wide, especially on RAM, samples, and you can use wide routine. For game, you have constraints. In example, you may need to use just a limited amount of RAM. You may use not all the four channels, because sometimes you want the musician want also to use to have some defects. And you may also need to be limited which channel you need to use. Like I have some example that I'll explain you later. And there might be some constraints in style, like in example, you know, if it's a platform game and it's like in the Middle Age, you cannot come up with a rough music, unless they want to be edgy. But sometimes, you want to choose some, want to have some constraints, or is the programmer that will tell you, I want the music to sound like this, and it happened. And also for the tools is another thing, because you cannot use like the modern DAWs to do music. You need to use trackers, and you need to come out like in 8-bit and then within a certain amount of range, like frequencies that are the frequencies of power, that frequencies that are compatible with the tracker, something that I can show you a bit later too. Usually for music on Amiga, we have, you know, Amiga came out in a transitional era. It was, we were coming from the arcade music, from the video game, they were having just basic music or some little accompanying melody. We were coming up from a more exhaustive approach. The game was not only just a game, but it started to be also an experience. So we started to have some games, like in example cinema, where Defender of the Crown, they were having their own teams, their own environment. They were trying to have a coherency, a consistency between the media, and other games instead they were a bit more like in the same way that the 64 game were, they were a bit more like free. Like in example, you might, you had a bomb jack that had like Jean-Michel Jarre soundtrack or things like that. So this was, and in the same time we were having the booming demo scene. That also affected the way some of the games were, like, the music were made. So there are a lot of people, better musicians like me, that they hear something good, like in example, they got tracking at them and they try to do something like that. Or they use a lot, or in an era like in the 80s and 90s, where resources were limited, including music samples, they were reusing a lot samples from other mod files, and from other games, or they were trying to sample from radio, from CD, or who got the money also from their own music keyboards, of course. That happened more on mainstream, or when people were more professional. In example, I remember that I stumbled in some music of Gustav Greffberg, that is known as Lizard King in the demo scene, and he was sampling its own thing, its own music from its own keyboards. And also put a big fat do not take this sample in the mod file, because you can rename the instruments and give messages. Some of the interest that I had as a musician, okay, when I was young, I was a lot. I had my cousin that he was 2 years older than me, and he was a lot in progressive music. So he exposed me to a lot of things like Pink Floyd, then Marillion, Genesis, and but what is, was left with me was Pink Floyd, Tangerine Dream, that is something that I got affected later, Jean-Michel Jarre. Then in Europe in the 80s, I had a lot of Italo-pop, techno-pop, that was a big influence. Then of course, Vangelis, house music, that was big, especially because when I was a, there's something that I don't want to put in my view. I hope we can. I hope we can edit it out. See. Yeah, I was talking about like that. When I got my Amiga, was 88, so we were in full house music. And that is important, because that was also another incentive for me to do music composing, because it was the era in which people can do in their home their own hit. Not that I wanted to do a house hit, but it was fun to do your own music. And then, of course, from the Amiga side, a lot of influence from the demo scene and from games. Of course, the big name like Whittaker, Usbeck was pretty big. I used also to tape all the music like from Turek and Apidia, listening on the car. Alistair Bimbo, okay. I mentioned Lizard King and Ibsen. Ibsen is another big influence, but it's a latter influence, it's more influencing me right now. Then Chroma, The Weasel is another artist that is pretty unconventional. You will find that they will do like valzer, you will find they will do polka, you will find they will do traditional music, Western music, all kinds of music. So it's coming out from the usual canon of the demo scenes. Then another one that I have is somebody that I like, I would say, compete with in one of, in the music competition that was in one of the Pixel Art Expo in Rome, Yuka Kujampa, also known as Dizzy. Is another one that is influenced me. He's on the soft bossa nova, jazzy, and other stuff too. And he really showed what a tracker can do. And of course, this is a bit of list of music that I did from the beginning. Besides the music for the quasar, I also did all the music for the game Powder. There are only five that went into the game, but I can tell you, in 8 years that we were trying to build the game, I did a lot of music. Also, because the game was supposed to have 8 stages, only 4 went in, the 5 went in the game, and so there are a lot of amazing music and tests. And all the new games, from Blocky Sky, Stance Furry, Dream of Raw One, there was actually, I had to flip this with Fernando Oliveira, is Dream of Raw One, not Bridge Strike. So that is a mistake of mine. Let's give to Caesar what is to Caesar. To Fernando what is to Fernando. Alarcity and Worthy that I worked with John Sakiris, that was a collab. I mean, I was doing part of the melody and then it was enriching or changing things. Then Bob Jack Beer Edition together with, that I did for McGeezer or Grant Cowie. And I also started to work on Rigger when I was starting when I was started with Alessandro Di Gaia, and I gave my work to Graham, but then he said that it was not the quality that he was looking for. He was looking for arcade perfect quality. I did work on it, and there will be something that I will show on that. But then at the end, he decided to work with, I forgot the name of the guy that is working right now with Graham, but yeah. DJ Neetoon, yeah. And then Barbarian Plus is another game that tell. Kiwi's Tale, recently I came out with the main opening of the Total Carnage Special Edition for the opening. I have a lot of games I don't even remember. I can mention SCDR that didn't come out for the R3D team. I can mention a couple of games with Super Robin and Diet Island the Astronaut, that were some of the first games that I was doing. I can mention Climby Skies, that is the same guy who Blocky Skies, but that didn't come out. And plus I also did work on some indie games. More free indie games. One is Despot Dungeon, that is a game that came out for Android. It was like a kind of rogue RPG, and I did the music that was in XM. And the Rockbot, that is like a Mega Man fan game, is an open source one. I redid all the music in Milky Tracker, Pro Tracker, also for channels. And it's a game that is available for PC, and it was available for Android, but then it got taken down because it was looking too similar to Mega Man. Right now he's working on a remake of this, is called Rock Droid. It will have the same basic, but he took everything to make it look like Mega Man. Then some of my music I've been also using some video, like an example, the Introduction to Eros is a video that I did because I also did advocacy for Aros, that is an alternate Amiga operating system for PC and also for Amiga itself, but that is another topic. Then I did the opening for the Guru Meditation channel and with Amiga Bill. And I also provided the music for the video Sami Alabi. That music comes from another game that is actually in pro. Oh yeah, Amos, did it? Box, the box is just it's just a mock-up. Being an open project, you can do whatever box you want, but yeah. And that game, that video, the one Sami Alabi, some of the music that they made for the R3D game, that is like a Metroidvania, they should come out soon, hopefully come out soon. They started to work at the Bridge Strike. Then I have other game in progress besides R3D. One is Proxima 3, that is a shooter for Amiga AGA. Then right over Moscow, that is made by Eric Hogan, and there is a remake for Amiga of the Commodore 64 game. It's made in BASIC. And Igwe Spirit is also made by Eric Hogan, and with the same graphic artist from R3D, that is Christoph Matis, that is a Polish one, very talented guy. And that is a road game. So, besides what I was talking about the demo scene and the game, they were affected a lot by demo scene, TV and show. I hear a lot of music on those games. And sometimes I think that maybe they should have gone another way. So one of the things that drive me to do music for games, especially now that we're on view, there is no more almost no more commercial interest and things like that, is that I decided I want to do games in the way that I would like to hear in a game, in a music. Sometimes I try to do an approach more cinematic, try to treat it like a movie or like one of the modern games. Try to have music that is less conventional, less Amiga, we'll say, because Amiga right now, they have a very, at least until the old Amiga game, most of the Amiga game, they have their very distinctive sound. You will hear say, this is an Amiga game 10 miles away, because a lot of them use the ProTracker ST disc. Some other, they use a lot of the demos in the style from the Norton, or they use a lot of techno music, of course, and but you can recognize most of them, they have their own approach. So where possible, I try to have a different approach on it. I try to research. In example, Barbarian Plus, I try to think, I was inspired a bit from the old TV movies, or from Conan, or from the other B movies that were doing music for game for the soundtrack of the movie, and try to do that approach. And also for R3D is another one that will come out soon, and for that I try to come out with a more dark sound that I usually do. And instead, Bridge Strike instead is very inspired by Top Gun and those games that, movies, game movies, also TV movies that came out in the 80s and 90s that were all about their fights and stuff like that. So I try to have a more cinematic approach. I try to give more a sense of what I would have liked to have the music, at least. I would have liked a music Top Gun in a River Raid game, One of the things that I did in some of the game music that I do, like using teaming. Teaming means, you have a team for one hero, you have a team for a situation, you have a team for a for another situation, you have a main team. Sometimes I use it a lot, in example, the most important where I use it is Rockbot. Rockbot, I made a main music team and then took out several pieces and tried to evolve to arrange those pieces and try to have it for an example, the team of the Doctor, Evil Doctor, the team for the stage menu, for the ice core, and to evolve this or to rearrange this in order to have a more consistent music, something that give you a universe consistency. And about talking about the Amiga games, usually we have the option that we have, the most traditional is this. So we have a music or sound effect. In this case, you will have a musician that use all the four audio channels. And then as option, you can have sound effect. So you cannot have both. And they will use, they will use either the four sound channel or will use the sound effect. So the pro, of course, is that you're gonna have a more immersive music, more complete music. You can be more relaxed, you don't have to worry. But then the cons, of course, is that you will not have sound effects, so that detracts a bit from the experience. Then we have the audio mixing music. This is another good one, in example, being used a lot by Factor 5 when they were using working in Amiga. And we use a little bit of that in Powder. Because you, so you will have some data that they, when possible they get mixed with the audio and you can, in one of the channel. Factor 5 is in the round music tracker that was the FMX, actually it's more like a music language as far as I remember, it's very complex. They were able to have like four channels mixing one channel, so three channels for sound effect and one channel they use it either for drum or for less important part of the music, and the other three channels for the music. And of course the cons is that you will need, they will take CPU time of course because the mix is made by the CPU and not by Paola. I think the mix will have a reduced quality. Channels. So that's why they might use it like for drums or for other things that you don't need to hear too much the quality. And then we have the three channel music that is the third most used option. And this one will leave one of the audio channel free for the sound effects. Okay, games that I know that I use it. One is Son of Chuck by Martin Nielsen, Chuck 2. And the Black Viper, this is by an Italian guy, Nicolian Tomljanovic. It's like a racing game, but post-atomic. And I love a lot the soundtrack because it's very inspired by what were the big movies of the 80s, all those post-nuclear things. And at the same time, it got affected also by Fist of the North Star, Okuto no Ken, for people to know manga, on the environment. And you will hear all this influence there. Actually, you will see the opening. It's very similar to the ending of the series of Okuto no Ken, really. It's like, you will see all the landscaping, the scrolling, and then all the things. Yeah. Okuto no Ken got a huge influence in Italy, especially when it came out, I can tell you. And then this is one of the least used options because it's one of the most difficult to manage, especially for a musician. So two-channel music. This means you will have two-channel audio for the music, two-channel for sound effect, of course, give more immersivity because you will have more audio at the same time, two-audio channel for the audio. That's what this is on Barbarian Plus, so you will have the two sound effects from the two players, and the music goes on the remaining two channels. It's hard for the musician because having only two channels, this means that it's easier that the music might get broken. It is hard to compose just for two channels. The best two-channel soundtracks that I know, okay, this is lit. Oh, by the way, Barbarian, you can download the ADF and the outside around. I have the label made by the graphic artist of Barbarian in my bag, you want me to get it?
Oh, okay, well, later on.
It does very well. Yeah, so it's very difficult to compose for two audio because you got to use a lot of tracks. And the best two-channel audio that I ever heard and it affect me a lot is Wolfchild. You will not recognize that this two-channel audio because it's very well made and very well positioned. And also, has a very important thing. All the sound, they are no more than 30 kilobytes each, that for a tracker music is very light. You will not say that. So the tricks that usually, at least that I use, especially when I compose music, when I have to do two or three channel music, are several. Some are by Fool in the Ear, Trompe l'Oreille, is in French. You might try to, like an example, have a drum beat and at the same time you need to have the bass. So what you will do, you will probably use something like, use my, like in the following audio track, you might try to put a lower note of the bass that look like, it might make think that the music has been already triggered, the audio, but it was not there, but your brain will fill the void. Sometimes you just put the drum, and if you don't know, you will not hear that the other bass is there or another chord. Then, some other time, when you might have like a string, you will use some, and you need, by the way, to have other things on the same channel, you will use the channel 9, that is for the fine-tune position inside the sample, And sometimes I calculate, I try to go with the scope and see where the music will hit. The sample will be at the position that is free, and then I add the music and I add the 9 samples so that it like, and it will like sound like consistent. You will think that it is going through despite of me. Then, sometimes we may use like, try to sample pieces of the music, like pieces of the drum and drumming going on, and use that instead of the film music. Or we can use chords. And to keep the memory light, we can use what we call, what I call micro sample. That means use very low, very small sample, like 100 baht or less. Mm. Then they will sound a little bit like chiptune, and then use all the common to modulate it. Next thing, I was working with, before when I was testing the audio, I was using a music that is from one of the games that I'm working right now. This is from Amiten, he's going to do a ninja game, and this is a team. This is using two channels, on the right two channels. This is Amos, so Amos usually use the first channel for first. So the sound effect will might end at the first of two channels. And this is using a lot micro sample. In this case, the sample, I use sample, I cut, trim it and loop it a lot. Like in example, let's see this. Or down sample it, like reduce the frequency. It's not a full, but it's not a full drum, but this is a drum that is being reduced, like in example, 1K, that for a drum is good, but is, and put it up, sorry. Sound like this, and this is like a two channel audio, just using the right two channel. Another thing that I do often sometimes is with the channel halfway or in the period, so that give more dynamic, it will keep the music more dynamic, because one time you will have the drum in the left side, the other time you will have the drum in the right side. I can give an example here. This is a two channel music. It's using the 8 channel to like take out the sample. And it's switching in between the two. Yeah, there was the test.
Is that a remake?
No, it's Bridge Strike. Oh. You know, they didn't choose the name when I started to work on the music yet. Yeah.
What's the tracker you use?
It's Milky Tracker.
Huh? Milky Tracker.
Milky.
Milky.
A lot of these are like work version. I try to keep it all together. Okay, this one. This one will use the mod, the 9 common trick in the middle to switch, and to switch like the back loop. So you will see that the music is like continue, the loop continues from one channel to the other. If it's the, yes, this. Now this is an old version. Let me see on the scope the two channels. So one channel will look in purple, other will look in yellow. And we see they like continuous because I found the right break point. Because sometimes they will ask me to keep the channel 3 free in assembler. Instead, Rowan is made in Amos, so they ask me to keep the channel 0 free in order to have some defect there. So sometimes there is not one game that does the same criteria. As you see, the guitar is pretty sharp if you use it like this. So the Channel 9 makes it start a little bit later, so it will be softer to re-trigger it. It will sound more natural. Together with the volume loop to make it more there. Song is interesting because I start in another way, then Amitan didn't like it. I say, what if I use the Smith, the Forest? They say, I like that, but I cannot use it because it's copyright. So I put it together. I put the same music and then I make it with the bass of the Forest of the Smith. No, it's not the Smith, it's the... Yes, it's not the Smith, it's... yes, the Smith. Yeah. Go back 1 second. Yeah. And by the way, you're like. So where I get my samples to do the music? A lot of it they came from ST Music, of course. A lot of it come from when I was in. I had my own mod collection that I take even from CDs. From the internet, ripping from disc, because that's what was before internet and stuff, using all the music ripper. Some of those did it on my own, sample CD, sample out, sample from tape, sample from VCR. And also I found some good resources. There are two resources on the Milky Tracker website. One is a Waveworld, where they I've sampled most of the old synthesizer. Then we have Key Archive, same link from, actually they have torrent link on Milky Tracker, and those are most like, maybe more classical instruments and stuff than I use from other free resources that you can find on the internet. In example, Sonatina, that are a lot of free samples from DAW, open source, but they're a web file. I can use that and resample it. Then free sound from org.org, that is a website where you can find a lot of samples. Looperman, if I want to get sample or gems, and then of course I work on it. And you can have it anywhere if you know where to look. Yeah, you can grab from YouTube, cut from YouTube, take out the audio. You can go around with your cell phone and record stuff. Yeah, it's more or less what the modern sound designer do. They try to find the idea. They can flip sounds, music. They can flip. They can put after normal music. That's what they do. I have the advantage compared to the modern musician that the low bitrate don't let me be more free because I don't have to worry about the sound quality too much up to a point. And sometimes I also use voices on my music, like in example, I had the music for Proxima where my wife like reading part of Psalm 34. Why? Because that is a kind of, I thought it was good for the final level of a game. Or sometimes I use like text-to-speech, you know, like maybe Siri or Alexa, I use those. I don't have a modern phone, so I cannot do the thing. Or so what I do sometimes, I either use some of those free services on the web. Some other time the service might not be that free, but then if you know how to use a code inspector, you can get something. And of course, I might use my microphone, and that's the third option. And for the conversion of music arcade, this is a good. Because as I say, I was working on the conversion of music. I did work in example for Bone Jack. For that, I use usually simple waveforms. I started in 2 channels, then people complained that the music was not good enough. I expanded in 3 channels. And they were still complaining that it was not good enough. That was a kind of tough one. There was some discussion, especially on Facebook and other groups there, and so I had to rework that a lot of time. And that's why Graham at the end was more like, he wanted absolute fidelity to the thing. DJ Meeting is using modern tools to try to work on the waveforms. And that I was unable to work on common time with things that were more on the quality that I was looking for. Then somebody in Facebook, a guy that is called Luca della Regina, point me to several tools that I might have used. Because at the beginning when I was simply using the Rigger MP3 music, graph from MAME, from the arcade emulator, and I was taking pieces of it and looping it, and he pointed me to a program called Hoot. Hoot is a sound player for Yamaha chips, or by the way, all those chips FM that were used from arcade games. And he also had some very good features, at least for me as a musician. You can turn on and off individual channels, and you can record on file. Those are good options. Let me see, did I start? Oh, no, I didn't start it because it's a bit processor intensive. I have a two screen, a second screen at home, and I hope you don't open on the CD, open on the second screen. So this is old. Okay. The only sound that I have here is Rigger, so that I was doing the grabs. Let me get another one. You can see I can turn off the audio. I can go. No, stop. I forgot to stop. Okay, stop. I can record the wave, and if I want this out, you know, and then I stop. I do the folder with all the tools. All right, for this one. And I have the sample now that I just recorded. I will open it in Audacity. I'm showing you the procedure, so that's what I did, because I did continue to work at least to see what was able to do for the Rigger soundtrack. And I came out to a very similar result to DJ Meeting, but I'm more. So this is the wave that I just recorded. Of course, I'm going to put it to mono because I don't need stereo. I'm doing an example. I can't open a new instance. At least I open a new instance, and other people just work on that. I amplify a bit. Ouch. Save it, of course, as a 8-bit audio. other compress file with assigning bit. By the way, Milky Tracker is using the, is also a fast tracker compatible, so it's using the XI format of samples. So it will, it can also, of course, load multiple samples for instrument, but right now we're using just, I'm using the, I use it for a single sample, and I will use it for 8-bit, of course. Yeah, because it can work in Pro Tracker mode or in Fast Tracker mode. Pro Tracker mode, you also keep the separation of the channels. Fast Tracker mode, you can have all the audio mixing. You can also test if you want to hear like more. Sample, I put it here. Yeah. So I just load my sample here. It might need some resample and some work. It's 51 kilobytes, of course, it's too big, so I had to. Use the resample option here of before the resample I want to increase a bit the value because the resample will bring some quality loss. Then I use advanced resample and bring it down to this should be 8363, that is the base frequency that you can get it tracked use. And then it's become 9 kilobytes more manageable. I can still shave a bit to some fade. Procedure that I use to resample for Riga. So using this procedure, I try to redo all the sample for Riga. This is my version of Riga sound that is that Graham did in here, but they were that I reworked so far. I try to see what I can keep out of it. So it's pretty similar to what DJ Meeting do. Problem is I'm not satisfied because it's too big for me, 250K. I will try to lower it a bit the sample, but. Yeah, and in game music, I tried to use two channels because I wanted to keep more sound. Well, instead, DJ Meeting used three. So those are all samples that I took with from the arcade simulation and then I downsampled here. Thank you. The file size right now is 237 kilobyte of all the sample and everything. That for a other game is acceptable, but for an ECS not. Oh yeah, this is my way to do stuff usually. When I do the soundtrack also for Bombjack, I put everything in one single mod file, and then so the coder might just do a point to what track he has to go, and they have everything together. It's the same way they work in Bombjack. Actually, I created this soundtrack I started before Tom Bombjack, and then yeah, Bombjack Beer Edition. By the way, call like this because there are some extra stages made by Graham and also extra music, of course. Here's another one that was tough to do, and I have to do to put the intro for Charlie. I work mostly with earphones, so sometimes they kind of hear separate, I cannot hear it too good, so I go here on the option, and I change the panning. This is the Amiga panning, you can play the other sound, which is kind of awkward, and then we have also the mono option, they put everything in the middle, so you will have the four channel over the same, the test to fit, if you want to. This is what I use when I export to Wave Audio to do audio tracks. Usually I use MPT player, and then I export with the balance 50%, so we'll have both the track together, because you know Amiga is very separated, very balanced, extreme left, extreme left for the two channels. At the end, that's what I did. I came back with Audacity, then I do the last work on Milky Track, and then I save the mod file. So some of the links that I have here, you can have my Bandcamp website where I sell some of the, actually sell. Most of the mod files that I do, they are Creative Commons, but I put also the track on sale there. I hope somebody will get it somehow. So far they didn't buy anybody, but you know, in case, because it tried to help me a bit when I was without a job, and in case to have like an extra income, then maybe good. And I have my YouTube channel where I put all the music. Usually I record from Pro Tricker PC. Yeah, I'm using this same machine, you know, so sometimes it's a bit slow. Then my Facebook page, I put the link for Hoot if somebody's interested to do experiments, and I put the link to Milky Tracker. And I want to say thank you to give me the opportunity to do this talk, and you will hear other stuff from me soon. I have other gaming progress. I hope I will also be able to do other stuff as I am for indie music or for other things. Thank you. So if anybody has questions, I can try to answer.
Questions for Simon, anybody? Questions? So what is the next game that's coming out with your music? What is the next one?
Okay, what I'm working recently, the one that I make you hear, that was two channels from Amit, and I know the world title is Ninja Ferrat. It's like about it's like a platform. I think he's having some idea from the old Ninja Gaiden, but I'm not too sure. Because he just asked me for the music, and then I went on for that.
Do you know when the release date will be for that next game?
No clue. He didn't say. And lately I'm too busy to follow I used to follow and also to participate to the Amitan channel, but then lately I've been too busy. Uh-huh. And because I'm working two jobs, so it's hard for me to go there. And then in the future, I know that hopefully Proxima will come out. Hopefully this year. I still have to finish the soundtrack. And then I know they finally start to work on R3D, that it was like in development now. And that's the from R3D team after Bridge Strike that came out 2 weeks ago. Actually, I want to say to the people, please go to PPA and get a copy, it's a good game. And even if it's a bit higher requirements, it was at least a 0.22 work, but yeah. And then what else is coming out in the future, I'm thinking, because I have a lot of projects. And some of those are, I did the music for some of the projects that were in the EIB competition. Like in example, there is a Super Pumpkin Brother that is kind of Snow Bros clone. I did the music for that, but that one is taking it easy. And I'm waiting for feedback from Amit, and that's it. That's the thing that right now I want. That the most imminent in the future, then if I have other project, I will let you know.
Simon, how do these game developers find you? Do they know you by reputation and then they say, make music for us? Or do you just go out to them and say, I can do music for you? Or
yeah, sometimes I do that. Sometimes I propose myself, I say, if you need any music, I can help you. Some other time they hear from others.
Oh, very good.
In example, Force did the music for another game of Colin. There was like a puzzle game called Block Off. And then, so he knew me and he proposed me for the music. Now he's porting two dungeon games. One, I forgot the name, that is like a kind of dungeon master, working like Dungeon Master, but I forgot the name. And for that one, the other round's not in that project, but yeah. For other, I start to cooperate, they don't like the music. Like an example, I propose some of the music to Michele Bormanini, also known as Sterilis, doing Invia, that is like an R-type kind of shooting game. I propose some of my music, but they didn't like it, so that's it, they found somebody else.
Thank you, Simon.
You're welcome.
You.